Revolutionary salutations to you. My name is Comrade Dostalos. I'm the General Secretary of the MDC Youth Assembly. I add my voice to the ongoing debate and discourse on the diplomatic visit by the African National Congress in Zimbabwe. My response is in two ways. Number one, the aspect of diplomatic relations. Number two, the issue of the ideological inclination of the visit by the Revolutionary Party to a sister Revolutionary Party, and the debate whether there is a crisis in Zimbabwe. First, the African National Congress resolved in its National Executive Meeting that there must be delegations sent to Zimbabwe in response to the socio-economic question and the political crisis in Zimbabwe that had raised alarm across the Limpopo River. And because of diplomatic relations that Zimbabwe has with South Africa for a number of reasons, number one, economic relations, number two, obviously the issue of geolocation within the southern region of our continent. The ANC delegation led by the Secretary General was mandated to look into the question of the Zimbabwean crisis and probably foster a conversation between warring parties in Zimbabwe. Number two, the historical debate around the relations between so-called revolutionary parties, who in our view as young people have lost its ideological compass. The revolutionary parties, for instance, went to a liberation struggle to fight for one man, one vote, to fight for land for the dejected black majority who were owners of the land and historically disadvantaged by colonizers in the African continent. But the two parties have found a convergence to distort the historical mandate of liberation movement by reversing the gains of the liberation struggle, first on the land question, but most importantly, also bastardizing the issue of one man, one vote as the crisis in Zimbabwe, according to us as young people, is born out of discontent and legitimized elections by the South African bodies and the African Union, who, in our own view, were contested. So these were the two, in my view, very critical issues to note. And most importantly now is that there's a crisis in Zimbabwe, and that can be disputed. First, there's an economic crisis in Zimbabwe. Secondly, there's a social crisis in Zimbabwe. People are dying. Our healthcare system is dilapidated. And most importantly, there's a political crisis in Zimbabwe. Those who govern have no responsibility or mandate from the majority of Zimbabwean citizens. In short, there is no social contract. There is no relationship between those who govern and those that are being governed. And therefore, there is chaos in the political, and the attempt by the regime to liberalize the economy without liberalizing politics has led us to the socio-economic quagmire that is affecting the majority of Zimbabwean citizens, thereby calling the African National Congress as the ruling party in South Africa to reflect on the Zimbabwean question and play a critical role in ensuring that the crisis in Zimbabwe is resolved before it escalates to further unprecedented levels that are not conducive for both Zimbabwe, South Africa, the region, and the continent at large. I think that the issue that came out for me as a young person very clear is that the ANC has not come to terms of appreciating the nature of the regime in Harare. The majority of African states and the world had an assumption that ZANU-PF was going to establish a competitive authoritarian regime in the post-Mugabe coup. But what is very clear is that Zimbabwe is under a pure fascist military state, and the African National Congress must know this regime for who it is. Because when the African National Congress made a resolution to meet different stakeholders as part and parcel of a process to mediate and negotiate Zimbabwe out of this crisis, which in my view is very important, because when you are resolving a political crisis, you must have convergence of different social forces. You must have labor, you must have students, you must have young people, you must have the civil society, you must have the church, you must have political parties coming together to foster a way forward for a troubled Zimbabwean society. And the template was bastardized purely because ZANU-PF, which is now a military government, made the condition that you can only talk to us and us alone. And when the delegation came, assuming that they're going to meet other stakeholders, ZANU-PF regime made it very clear that you meet with us and you go back, and there's no crisis in Zimbabwe. And according to them, the problem is sanctions and the exhausted nationalist rhetoric that they parachuted during their short press release, which was ideologically vacuous and not thorough in terms of appreciating the crisis in Zimbabwe. I think the regime has been exposed, and we've argued as young people that the military regime in Zimbabwe has failed to understand the 21st century consequential question. It is wearing on the other hand our government gangs firing tweets and government gangs firing bullets, and all the other hands are young people firing tweets. Social media and the arena of new digital technology has exposed the regime. The 18th century regime in Harare attempted to take and doctor CCTV pictures and videos to assume that our trio, the MDC trio comprising of Joanna Mamombe, Cecilia Chimbiri, and Nitsai Chiroa, it effected an abduction. But they were exposed, showing beyond any shadow of a doubt that the regime has lost the ability to foster and control. The opposition is at the center of abductions. Two, that the opposition is actually doctoring and manufacturing stories that in Zimbabwe there is a crisis. But it is now very clear. It's now 2 weeks after a video of Tando Mucheyua was exposed, a car that was used by, that was hired by the regime from Impala car rentals was exposed, its number plates and the type of automobiles that were used to abduct and torture Tawanda Mucheyua, who is an ordinary citizen exercising his freedom. But the regime attempted to use the same script to attempt to doctor a video that, because the regime was exposed a few weeks ago and they wanted to expose the opposition. But their attempt failed because they were exposed that, number one, the videos that were used, the so-called CCTV camera videos did not match. Number two, they used a BMW, whereas they were assuming that Joanna Mamombe was using a Mercedes-Benz. The work by the regime was very clumsy, and they used state resources. Legally, again, that was wrong, because if you have evidence, produce it in a court of law. Go and produce it, but this court is still under trial. So it exposes the bastardization and capture of the judiciary in this country, and disregard of the same by the executive that captured power through a military coup in November 2017. Of course, the exposure that happened, where Joanna Mamombe, who is a rightful Zimbabwean citizen, who has a right to religion, who has a right to freedom of movement, who has a right to move freely in this country, her rights were abrogated and bastardized by the regime. But again, it exposes the conflation of the state and ZANU-PF, because Tendai Chirao, whatever position he has in the Youth League of ZANU-PF, despite that he is far beyond a definition of a young person by any standards, it was exposed when he went on Twitter to expose images of Joanna, assumed images of Joanna Mamombe in somewhere out of Harare, where they say she was praying. Number two, those images were then released by Herald and ZANU-PF controlled newspapers, And Chirau released them before the headline that we saw today, exposing the conflation of the state and ZANU-PF in Zimbabwe, which is a very huge problem because Herald takes instructions from ZANU-PF. Chirau makes a headline and you see it in Herald tomorrow. So it exposes their incompetence, it exposes the state in using taxpayers' money to follow citizens who are not criminals. If there is any charge laid on Jala Mamombe, Cecilia Chimbire and Netsai, the regime must go to court and the court must give a fair trial. That is the essence of natural justice, that the essence of Audi Ataram Petain, which is a key principle of natural justice, which is to hear the other side of the story and make a judgment thereof. So all the things that are happening are exposing that Zimbabwe is truly in a deep political crisis, that we must, as young people, unite and rescue this country from the mercenaries currently presiding over the motherland. Thank you very much. I think that the organizer of the 31st July demonstration was Ngarvume, and he made press statements that led to his arrest in calling for a demonstration. But as a revolutionary young person who is mandate from the majority of members of the democratic movement and young people in this country, I have made it very clear that demonstrations are a constitutional right. And the points that were raised by Ngarvume, there's consensus within the broader society in Zimbabwe that ZANU-PF has failed, that the fight against corruption must continue unabated. And at the center of that fight was the element of state capture. And I believe that this is a consensus-driven dispossession by different citizens in this country, that truly we must fight against corruption. There is no way we can have a crisis in this country, in the health sector, given the amounts of money that are being looted by the regime in Harare. So our belief and conviction as young people that demonstrations is a right, and we shall continue demonstrating. And we know that the regime is going to respond ruthlessly against those who call for demonstrations, against those who participate. But we shall continue with our mandate to mobilize and continue to demonstrate without fear or favor. Now, the position of the Youth Assembly is very clear, that the regime is using politics to criminalize our councillors and leaders in local authorities. There is no doubt that ZANU-PF is at the center of corruption in this country. And there is no single prosecution that has been done and councillors found guilty by whether the police, by the different commissions that have been given investigative and arresting powers in this country. So the assumption that councillors are corrupt is an attempt to strike moral equivalence, that MDC is corrupt and ZANU-PF is corrupt. They want to assume that we're an asymmetrical reproduction of the very same sobriquet that we are fighting. And the regime has failed to do so because they were exposed by Hopewell Chingono that they are corrupt in the health sector. And corruption in this country is centered in three areas: pharmaceuticals, minerals, and in purchasing. There is a clear sign that the regime is looting, the regime is using its control of the executive to allow different nationalities to come and loot in this country. Just recently you saw the head of state calling Chinese people to come and mine in an area where it has been reserved to be a park for wild animals, showing the lack of ideological compass, the lack of green understanding in the regime in Harare, but also again the attempt to squander and destroy this country by Emmerson Mnangagwa as the greatest haste that has ever happened in the history of Zimbabwe. I think that you know ZANU-PF and the way they want to use anything to arrest Advocate Nelson Chamisa. And if they had a single suspicion that President Chamisa had looted even a fly, he would have been arrested. They would have tried to coin something to say, no, a fly is a state asset and you have looted a fly. He was going to be arrested for that. So the state has no evidence, has no anything against President Advocate Nelson Chamisa, and they cannot. That's why up to today they have failed. They've tried to criminalize him, they've tried to accuse him of everything and anything. but they have failed to prove anything against him. So any allegation that you might hear in the corridors of ZANU-PF is false, fabricated, and we are able to prove our accusations of the regime in terms of its corruption scandal, and they can't prove anything against our leadership. The only thing they want is to strike moral equivalence against the leadership of the democratic movement in Zimbabwe. Thank you. My message to young people, in particular my brother Tawanda Moyo, who's turning 29 today, is that fellow comrades, fellow young persons, it's time we reconvene and open the future whom the present is holding in suffocation. We cannot suffer forever. There is no struggle without bruises. There is no struggle without pain. But it's high time we reconverge and fight and convince fellow young people that the mandate to fight, as Frantz Fanon put it, is our generational mandate, and we must fulfill it in no time, in no fear, in no favor. I thank you. I salute you.
For these and other stories, visit our website www.263chat.com. Follow us on Twitter @263chat and like our Facebook page, 263chat.